Good afternoon, and welcome to this Sunday afternoon at the Met, a celebration of our Thinking Outside the Box exhibition, certainly more uplifting than war, I would hope. At any rate, my name is Daniëlle Kisluk-Grosheide. I'm a curator in the Department of European Sculpture and Decorative Arts, and I was responsible for this exhibition. But as we all know, an exhibition is always a collaborative effort, and I would like to thank my colleagues in the department for their enthusiastic support of the idea and letting me roam the storeroom, chasing down ever new boxes that I didn't know their existence of, and my colleagues in the Objects Conservation Department, who treated an endless stream of objects for the exhibition. We have about 100 boxes, all European and all from our own collection in the show, and nearly all of them needed treatment, so I'm very grateful to the objects conservators, as I am also to Joseph Kosha, our photographer, who photographed nearly as many of them, and then for the designers in the design department for coming up with a lovely design and for beautiful graphics. Well, many months ago, even months before the exhibition even existed, Joseph Lowe of the Education Department came in his very efficient and organized way to me and said, well, do you want a Sunday afternoon at the Met? Yes. So how would you like to call your talk? And at that moment, we came up with the title, Thinking Outside the Box, Placing European Cabinets, Caskets, and Cases into Context, which many months ago seemed like a very good idea. Only more recently, when I started to collect my thoughts for today's presentation, I was thinking, what did I have in mind when I came up with that title? Because how could I possibly put into one context objects as diverse as this very large and incredibly heavy strongbox, which has really been a bit like the magnet of the exhibition, very large, nearly 800 pounds, made in Nuremberg, of steel, really, for the safekeeping of documents and gold. How can I possibly put that in the same context with a tiny little bonbonniere made in England in the 18th century of enamel, which was used for to store little sweets in? What was I thinking with that title? Or how could I possibly compare an absolute fantastic object which really belongs in the realm of the Kunstkammer, this lovely amber casket, which was made in what's today Poland, put together of three different types of amber, translucent, opaque, and the milky white variation, and then with these lovely engraved scenes on the translucent pieces. How could I possibly compare that with the roughly contemporary embroidered casket, which was made in England, perhaps by an amateur, a young lady who was taught to embroider, decorated with lovely scenes of the life, from the life of Joseph, always a wonderful, virtuous topic. How could I possibly do that? Was I opening a Pandora's box here? And that in itself turned out to be a bit of a misnomer, because when I started to reread the Greek tale by Hesiod, it actually turned out that the Greek god Zeus, or Jupiter, gave the mortal Pandora a gift, and he told her not to open it. But of course, overcome by curiosity, Pandora, when she was back into the human world, couldn't help herself but open her gift, thereby unleashing an endless stream of evil over mankind. But it actually turned out that what Zeus gave her was not a box, but a jar. Because in Greek, the word pitos was used, and you classicists out there will know this, which means nothing more than a lidded jar. But it was due to the 16th century humanist Erasmus, who used the Latin word pyxis to translate the Greek tale into Latin, and pyxis means small casket or box, and thereby forever changing the tale. And we can't imagine it without a Pandora, without a box. But to get back to our exhibition, I think there is something incredibly personable about boxes and small cabinets and caskets. Boxes have long played a very important role in our everyday life. We have always looked for objects to store our personal belongings in. And there is an incredible variety both in size, in shape, and in the materials that you could make those objects from, as the exhibition, I think, quite well illustrates. But there is something more. Not only could these boxes be very beautiful and be made of very precious materials, they could also become actually the object of the collector to collect in itself, more than just the case for a treasure to store inside. And then there is always that possibility of something of a surprise or a treasure, a hidden secret inside. And I think that this ebony coffer is a beautiful case in point. It was very likely made in Amsterdam in the middle of the 17th century, and its rectangular outline is lovely enlivened by these sculptural term figures at the corners, lifted up these elegant ball feet, and then the curving outline of the superstructure. And if you pay close attention, you see that the unknown cabinet maker who was responsible for this box actually very cleverly alternated plain ebony with Macassar ebony, creating this lovely alternating effect in the wood. You see the plain black ebony here, and then this striated Macassar ebony in the center and also repeated here on the lid. So it is a lovely object from the outside. But then, talking about surprises, look, when you open it, you find that in the inside there is far more color than the severe black from the outside. You find that it is lined with these lovely painted alabaster panels, both inside the lid as well as on the drawer fronts. Really quite a surprise. And then you can open the interior panel, allowing a little architectural perspective interior to become visible. And the idea was that you could place a small treasured object inside that interior, which could then be seen from all sides, from the front and the back, through the mirrors that line the walls. So much for the surprise. How about the secrets? Well, this coffer could certainly hide your secrets as well, because once you open the drawers, and here they are not made of pine or of oak, as you would come to expect, but they're made of this beautiful tropical padauk wood. And we have to remember that Amsterdam was a very important harbor for the importation of exotic woods during the 17th century. That in the back of this double drawer, there is actually a hidden secret drawer underneath. And this is repeated at various other places inside this cabinet as well. So there are surprises and possible secrets that are hidden within this cabinet. Well, as the exhibition illustrates, there are objects of all different materials, but also for all different types of usage. Some were used on the table, like this lovely scalloped-shaped silver box that dates to the early 17th century to England. And very often, these scalloped-shaped boxes have been described as spice boxes, but more recently, one has come to think that they might actually have been used for the storage of sugar. And we have to remember that the English love to sweeten their wine with either honey or sugar. So this sugar box was not for to sweeten the tea or coffee, but to sweeten the wine, perhaps. And it really is a lovely, lovely example. The other one is an octagonal silver spice box. It is a double spice box. It has two lids that can be lifted up, and probably for the storage of either salt and pepper, or perhaps of cloves and pepper. And as an additional benefit, it has a removable nutmeg grater in the center, which is really quite lovely. Here we are. This can be removed, and then you can grate your nutmeg with it. These spice boxes would be placed on the table during the dinner time, and it either was placed in front of each diner to have his own spice box, or perhaps between two dining guests that they had to share. Other boxes or cases were more functional, like this leather case, which has a very unusual shape, and you will only understand it as, when you see what was placed originally inside this silver gilt equelle, which is nothing more than a covered bowl for broth to take a little bouillon or hot soup early in the morning. And these leather boxes were specifically created sometimes to hold one such object or a group of objects to avoid tarnishing and to avoid scratching. But if the original content was lost, you would have a hard time figuring out what it was meant to hold inside. Then there are a number of objects in the show that were created as a result of a new pastime in Europe, that was the taking of tea. Tea is now such an important aspect of our daily lives that it is hard to imagine that the Europeans were first introduced to tea only in 1610. And even by then, it was not commonly taken. It was only taken just for medicinal purposes, because tea was thought to be sort of a cure-all, good for to heal all kinds of afflictions. And it is only in England, after the arrival of Catherine of Braganza, the queen consort of Charles II, towards the end of the 17th century, that tea becomes a much more fashionable beverage and taken by many more elegant people. And as a result, if tea becomes an regular drink to be enjoyed, then of course you need furnishings to help you take tea. And at that point, you start seeing that special tea tables were created, as well as, of course, tea services and cups and saucers and sugar boxes and so on. And of course, one also needed to store the precious tea leaves in. Since tea remained a costly drink for a very long time, it was always advised to have a tea box that you could lock. And you see here a lovely example of mahogany dating to the middle of the 18th century, which shows some resemblances to designs that were published in the Cabinet Maker's Directory by Thomas Chippendale. It's not exactly the same, but it's similar, and you see the bronze handle as well as the bronze escutcheon. There was once a key so that you could lock your tea leaves away from the servants. Another popular pastime or habit, a bad habit as that, was the taking of snuff, which became extremely popular in 18th century Europe and particularly in France. And you will find lots of references to that in contemporary literature. And if I just read you what the British traveller and writer Tobias Smollett noted in 1763, and I quote, "A true bred Frenchman dips his fingers embrowned with snuff into his plate filled with ragout. Between every three mouthfuls, he produces a snuff box and takes a fresh pinch with the most graceful gesticulations." Obviously, this bad habit was also mocked, as you can see clearly in this delightful mice and monkey. And you see how he does it just right. He's holding the box very elegantly and takes a little pinch of snuff and puts it on his nose. Well, snuff was deemed to be a very healthy habit initially, that it would produce the sneeze and clear the mind and be healthy to the whole system. Only later on was it known that it became very addictive and not so good and healthy at all. But however it was, many, many people took snuff, and for that reason, a host of beautiful snuff boxes were produced. I know that our next speaker will deal with these golden snuff boxes, so I'll show you just one of our porcelain ones, because they could be made of all kinds of different materials as well, including of porcelain, like this lovely shell-shaped box, which shows you just wonderful shells and marine plants modeled both on the lid and on the bottom of the box. And these boxes always had hinged lids and were very tightly closed so that the snuff would stay fresh and wouldn't lose its scent. Another pastime that certainly inspired the making of boxes was the love for gaming and gambling. There was a lot of extra time on the people's hands, which they would really use to play cards or other table games. And as a result, again, card tables and gaming tables were created, oftentimes with a folding lid and the inside then being lined with velvet or baize. There were even special chairs for spectators who could sit astride and lean on the cresting of the back to watch the gamblers play on. Not surprisingly then, that there were also made some boxes, and this is a really lovely one made of porcelain, in Meissen, in Germany, near Dresden, where already the decoration of the lid clearly indicates the use for it during card games. As a matter of fact, the cards that you see depicted on top are actually copied after an existing set of cards that was created in the 17th century in France, specifically for export to Germany. And what is very interesting is that you find here on the left-hand side various duty marks, because these French or foreign playing cards, if they were brought to Germany, the owners had to pay tax or duty on it, and the painter at Meissen even reproduced those duty marks. It's very amusing. And once you open it, you see that the interior originally would have had four small boxes, and then each would have held the different types of counters to be used at the card game. And then the interior of the lid has this lovely floral arrangement placed on the edge of a table. Really quite extraordinary. And luckily, many of the counters have survived. It became very clear to me that working on this exhibition that many of the objects in the show had something to do with the daily dressing practices of the past. And this is nothing new. As way back as the old Egyptian period, boxes were created to keep the various dressing implements and the cosmetic articles together. You find the smaller box on the right is one here in our own collection, whereas the one on the left is one in the British Museum, where even all the original implements have been preserved inside, including the coal to darken the eyes. So this custom didn't change, even though the shape and the decoration of the boxes changed over time. The earliest object in the exhibition is this Pastiglia casket, which was made in Italy. It is a wooden box that has been completely gilded and then has been decorated on each side and on the lid with a series of white, almost gesso-like figures that were molded in molds and then glued to the wooden surface. But as a matter of fact, these are not made of gesso, but of a white lead powder to which a little bit of musk paste was added. And this musk paste, which was also the basis of many of the perfumes in the Renaissance period, would make these boxes actually kind of aromatic. And the idea was that the owner would be invited to pick this box up. It is rather small, so you could easily lift it up. And because it was decorated on all sides, the owner would be invited to turn it around in her or his hands through the heat of the hand. The scent of the musk would come free. And we have to see this not just as a lovely aromatic box, but we have to see it in the time that in the Renaissance, where of course personal hygiene was not what it is today, that there were lots of foul odors. And it was believed in those days that foul odors were the carriers of disease. Terrible diseases like the Black Death, the plague, for instance, could be carried supposedly by bad odors. But you could counteract that and protect yourself by surrounding yourself by good odors, pleasant odors, perfumes, and so on. So if you understand this box in that context, it takes on a whole new meaning. Now, many of these boxes, and there are quite a few preserved, we have only a few in this museum, but there are others in other collections, they show you depictions quite often taken from tales celebrating love and beauty and marriage. And not surprisingly, these caskets were often given as lovely betrothal gifts to a bride. And then if you remember that musk was also considered to be an aphrodisiac, it all made total sense. Now, we don't quite know what was kept inside, but I could just imagine some lovely ivory combs or some personal ribbons or other objects that a bride or a young woman might use during her daily dressing ritual. And we have to also remember, by the way, that this white lead powder that was used for these figurative decorations was also the basis of many of the cosmetic products of the time. White, the whiteness of the skin being the highest beauty possible, and women, beautiful women with pale skin were often compared to ivory. That was the highest beauty beauty point that you could reach, that of course this white lead was not very good for you. If you pasted that on your face, you could easily suffer from blood poisoning, and that would result in blemishes of the skin, and your hair might drop out, and ultimately you could die from it. Well, Italy really created many of these cosmetics, including these white paste for the face to heighten the pallor of the skin that was usually called a Venetian ceruse. And if you added some color to it, then you could create rouge. And from Italy, these cosmetic products traveled all throughout Europe, particularly after Catherine the Medici had married the King of France, Henry II, in this late 16th century. And she brought with her all this love for the use of perfumes and beauty products. And from there, it really traveled all over Europe. And we find it also reflected in numerous writings. For instance, Thomas Platter, who was a Swiss-born medical student, traveled to Spain. And he wrote in his diary in 1599, and I quote, "Spanish women are very fond of their toilette and love nothing so much as to beautify themselves. Their slippers are of a prodigious height. The fashion is to put an outrageous amount of powder and paint on the face. The color is supplied in little pots." From this comes a saying that alludes to this painting and these shoes: who has a Spanish wife has four. One tall and one short, one beautiful and one plain. But it just goes to say that already by the late 16th century, the love for beautifying yourself with these usually Venetian products was spread all over Europe. And as a result, you wanted to keep your cosmetics together. And certainly also in Venice, some beautiful coffers were made, or cofanetto as it would be called in Italy, to store these various beauty elements and these cosmetics together. This is a particularly lovely one dating to the late 16th century. It is a wooden coffer which is completely decorated with painted and lacquered decorations in sort of arabesque style, which was brought over from the Middle East. And that reminds me very much of some of the Near Eastern bookbindings that were created at that time. And then look at this gilded silver handle. Are these little sirens that are decorating the handle? Who knows? We know that the interior, which is not left intact, originally was divided into various compartments and had a removable tray, as well as a mirror inside the lid, really to make it easier for you to beautify. Well, ever since the 16th century, the daily grooming ritual known as the toilette, and this word toilette really comes from nothing else than the word toile, which means cloth in French, and it was the cloth that was spread over the table on which you would put your various beauty implements on top. And you can see it quite well here in this lovely English picture of about 1600, where you find Elizabeth Vernon while she is combing her hair with a lovely ivory comb. And you see on the table next to her, which is, functions as a dressing table at this moment, a cloth, but also this this lovely opened box where you have the various compartments as well as the mirror inside the lid, and then a whole array of jewelry spread out on the table. So perhaps she kept her jewelry in there, but she may also have kept her combs and brushes in there as well. And more would you find these portraits of ladies almost like Venus while beautifying themselves all throughout the 17th and 18th century. You find countless ladies, even queens and mistresses of kings, portrayed while at her dressing tables. And it was really a semi-public event, a daily ritual to beautify yourself and to get dressed. We know this very well from a beautiful description of this formidable lady that you see here, Elizabeth Charlotte, the Duchesse d'Orléans. She was the sister-in-law of Louis XIV, and she originally came from Germany. And she wrote fantastic letters stating very frankly her opinions. And she described in one of the letters of 1721 that what her daily routine was, that she would get up early in the morning, write some letters, and then after she had given herself a little cat wash, she had put on her dressing gown, she would be sitting down at her dressing table, and then, and I quote, Everybody, men and women, enters while my hair is being done. When I am coiffed, all the men, except for my doctors, leave the room, and I put on my shoes, my stockings and drawers, and I wash my hands. Then the doctor crew leaves the room, and my tailor comes in with my dress. I put it on as soon as I have put on my chemise. When I am all laced up, all the men come back in. And when I'm dressed, usually at 11:45, I go to the chapel. So this description gives you a good idea that this was a semi-public ritual to be repeated every single day, and that you could receive a whole lot of people while you were in the act of getting ready for your day. It's very hard for us to conceive of that idea, because we really don't want anybody to see us before we have brushed our teeth, do we? And this continued, this semi-public ritual, and it was for men as well as for women. It continued, and it was particularly popular in France. And again, there are many descriptions of this. And you see in this etching and engraving also, indeed, that there are a whole lot of people in the room while the lady is sitting at her dressing table, possibly even merchants trying to sell her a new fabric, perhaps her servants who came to get the orders for the day, her friends, perhaps her husband, or in this case, you might even imagine that a lover came to pay his mistress a visit. And again, some of the English travelers to France give us wonderful descriptions of it. Philip Thicknesse wrote in 1767, and he was one of those travelers who published his journal, and I quote, "To be admitted into a French lady's bedchamber before she is up is as common as it is to see her afterwards. And if she chooses to shift herself while you are in the room, she will look upon you as very ill-bred if you do not assist her in putting her clean shift over her head. Nor will your presence deprive her from attending to the calls of nature." So it was very, very public indeed, and I said very difficult for us to understand. But if it was such a semi-public event, you can also imagine that on these dressing tables, which have been compared at times as altars of love and beauty, that you wanted to have very beautiful sets to be placed on these tables. We have in the exhibition this late 17th century English dressing table set, which includes numerous boxes as well as a pair of candlesticks and a pin cushion, of course a dressing table mirror and so on, various pots for pomades and other cosmetics, which was created for the most part by William Fowle. Now these elaborate dressing table sets were often gifts of a groom to his future bride. And since such a gift had to be ready by a certain date, it is not uncommon to find that multiple silversmiths were involved in the making of such an elaborate set. This particular set has a lovely chased engraving of chinoiserie figures. And it really reminds me of this 1690 piece of poetry that was written by Mary Evelyn, where she really describes a set of dressing table plate, very much like the set we just saw. And if you just read it for yourself, you see of the different components. These sets could consist of as many as 30 different pieces for cosmetics, the candlesticks, the snuffers, the snuff dish, etc., etc. You really get an idea. And if you start to look for this kind of information, you find so many references to the toilette, to the daily dressing ritual, that you feel that it was indeed a very important aspect of the daily life of the people of quality. We have, not in the exhibition but in the museum, a somewhat later beautiful set made in Augsburg, dating to the 1740s, again with even more pieces than the previous set, which is still kept in its original cover, and that's indeed how the boxes were preserved in another box, which was usually filled with various compartments, specifically created to shape of the various objects to avoid scratching and also to avoid tarnishing. And it really comes to mind that these beautiful sets were almost more for display to tell your visitors of the status and the quality that you had than for actual daily use. This particular set was made in Augsburg in Germany, which was a very important town for the making of silver. And if you were in the market for such a silver dressing table set, Augsburg would be one of the places where you could go to order such a beautiful set. We have what we think is a set also created in Augsburg is this miniature coffer. It's really very small, complete with its miniature silver inside, showing you almost toy-like dressing table set. But I don't think it was so much meant to actually play with as more for the young ladies to practice in a way their future role as lady of the house. And you find various boxes of round or rectangular shapes, the candlesticks, and even some tablewares, because it was not unusual to use your first meal of the day while in the act of dressing. After all, it could take as many as 5 hours, and you would get certainly very weak if you hadn't eaten anything. The only thing that is not present here, and we wonder if it ever had been there, is a mirror. Very often these mirrors were stored in the lid of such coffers, but here there is no clear indication that there ever was a mirror, but you would expect it. It certainly is a very rare set, and although it is not marked with any maker's mark or any city mark, we can be pretty sure that it was made in Augsburg based on comparison with several such miniature sets that have been preserved in Munich, in the museum there. Well, not always have these sets been preserved intact, and I just show you one more of these dressing table series just to point out this little rectangular box here. These rectangular boxes were often called root boxes, and we have one in the exhibition which may or may not have been part of such a French dressing table set. I don't believe, but I would love to ask Charlie this question, if he knows of such root boxes from English dressing table sets or not. But certainly in France you find them. And this is a particularly lovely one dating to about 1730. It has this sarcophagus shape, beautiful molded outline, and then this rich gadrooning around, which would also lovely reflect the dancing light of the candles. Wonderful chasing, and then an image of abundance on the top. Well, this is a root box, and that of course piqued my interest, thinking, well, what do you put inside this root box? And nobody really knew, so we started to look, and then ultimately came up with the idea that the taking care of your teeth was very important at the time as well. And we found a reference that Sir Ralph Verney, by the end of this 17th century, was requested by a friend to inquire in Paris, and I quote, for the little brushes for making clean of the teeth, together with some petite boîtes or boxes to put them in. And then by going on some more in the Toilette of Flora, Toilette of Flora, which was published in London in 1784, we find actual lovely recipes of making such toothbrushes. And they suggest that you take the roots of rather woody plants, such as marshmallow, for instance, that you take six inch length, that you boil them, dry them, and then cut the ends at either end into little brushes, which you then could dip into some sort of abrasive powder to clean your teeth. Nevertheless, people in the past suffered a lot from toothaches and swollen gums. The loss of teeth was also a frequent occurrence, and you find very often references to little plumpers, little textile bags that people would put inside their cheeks to fill up the hollow that was left behind by the loss of teeth. I mustn't think of that, really. But this is then one of these lovely boxes in which you could put your handmade toothbrushes in. Some of the dressing table sets were clearly catered for men and would have had these silver spherical-like boxes for sponge and for soap. Those wash bowls, as they were called, were usually made in bowl shape. It was nothing more than pot ashes mixed with oils and dried herbs and flowers, and then formed in the shape of a ball, and that was your soap. And then the one with the pierced lid would be for the sponge, so that it could dry after the shaving had taken place. And of course, there would have been a series of knives to help you with your daily shaving practices. Well, not always these dressing table sets were made of silver, as you can clearly see here on this lovely painting that was on the art market. You could have red lacquered wood sets, or these lovely Bois de Sainte-Lucie sets were also very popular early in the 18th century. This is a very dense fruit wood, very likely a cherry wood, which was then carved in these wonderful patterns, very much repeating the decoration that you would have found chased or embossed in silver. And this wood was that came from the Lorraine area in France near Nancy, where the patron saint was Saint Lucie, and hence the wood is called Bois de Saint Lucie. And when the wood is fresh, it has not only a lovely reddish color, which could be enhanced by dyes, but it also had a very nice scent reminiscent of cinnamon. Other boxes could be made of lovely bullwork, and we were recently able to acquire a pair of these bullwork boxes, that is tortoiseshell and brass. Very similar to the box that is held by the daughter of Madame Marcelier in this painting by Nattier. So it was for us very nice to be able to combine the painting with these two boxes. And although the boxes are a little earlier than the painting, it gives us an idea that these bullwork boxes remained fashionable for a long time, because Madame Marcelier was a very fashionable lady, a bit of a social climber, and she would not have wanted to be depicted by something that was démodé or old-fashioned. And then also used for various dressing implements was this lovely wooden casket that is decorated with straw work, with marquetry of straw. It is an unusual material, very inexpensive, of course, and you have to imagine when the straw was fresh, it would have this lovely golden color. And if you chose your straws based on different plants, and you could enhance them with dyes, you could create lovely decorations almost resembling bullwork marquetry. The cover of this casket has a triumph of Venus. Again, Venus was the god of beauty and love, so very likely various dressing implements would have been stored inside. And then this is the surprise inside, where the different dyes have been better preserved than on the outside. Very colorful indeed. The care and styling of the hair was important, of course, too, during the daily dressing ritual. And ever since the first quarter of the 17th century, when Louis XIII in France started to wear wigs, many of his courtiers followed suit. It took a little bit longer in other countries to take over this adoption of the wig. And it is by the 1660s that Samuel Pepys, who this wonderful diarist who shared all his inner thoughts with us in his diary, started to think about should he use a wig or not. But he wasn't so sure initially. He had a hard time to get his hair cut off. But then he said, yeah, I think I should go that way because it is such a pain to keep my hair clean. It was in November of 1663. So he had his hair cut off, he ordered a wig, and then the next day he stopped at a trunk maker to order a case for his wig. Now, we have no idea what that case looked like, but we do have in the exhibition a lovely example of a wig cabinet that was created by Daniëlle Sommer for a prince bishop, Gottfried von Gutenberg, in Germany. And this illustrates quite well, I think, how elaborate these wig cabinets could be. Not only the main compartment for the storage of the wig, or plural, maybe multiple wigs, and then the various drawers to keep your brushes and curlers and powder inside. Everything you needed to keep the wig in good order. Very important also was the use of cosmetics, and particularly of patches. Now, this custom of putting a little black velvet or taffeta patch on your skin allegedly goes back to the 16th century, when people were suffering from toothaches, they put a little bit of ointment underneath a black patch and put it on the outside of their cheek. Obviously, that didn't do anything to cure you from your toothache, but somebody noticed very quickly that this little black patch would beautifully enhance the whiteness of your skin, and a new fashion was born for both men and women. And you see here then, the next step was, of course, to create a lovely little box to put these patches in. And this particular box of agate and gold was made in England. Perhaps it was made specifically to be sold in France in the so-called magasin anglais, where English luxury goods became available to the Parisian clientele. You could wear more than one patch at a time, as you see here in this engraving after Boucher, where the lady already is wearing, I think, three patches and is about to put another one on, and the placement in on the face could also have a hidden message. And then these little boxes, they were not only for patches, but also for rouge. And although on the outside they resemble very much snuff boxes, the interior compartments give their use away, because they have the little lidded compartments for the patches and the rouge, but they also have the tiny little brush and a little mirror to help you put the rouge in the right place. And you see here then how Madame de Pompadour is just in the act of applying some rouge in her face, while holding a little rouge box in her hand. Well, all this use of cosmetics was not always looked so favorably upon, and we have then a lovely quote of Madame Mary Wortley Montagu, who traveled widely on the continent, and she wrote to one of her friends in 1718, "Apropos of countenances, I must tell you something of the French ladies. I have seen all the beauties and such, and I can't help making use of the coarse word, nauseous creatures, so monstrously unnatural in their paint, and on their cheeks, to their chins, unmercifully laid on a shining red japan that glistens in a most flaming manner, that they seem to have no resemblance to human faces." So not everybody approved of this wide use of rouge and makeups. And I'd just like to conclude today's presentation with showing you a few necessaires. These are these small pocket boxes, oftentimes very preciously made of, in this case, tortoiseshell and gold, which would house a whole host of little miniature implements that either for tweezers and tongue scrapers and a spoon to clean the ears, little patch boxes, and sometimes these objects were also, these objects of beauty were also combined with writing equipment or sewing equipment, really quite extraordinary. And this must have been something new in the 18th century, because again, the Duchess of, or the Duchesse d'Orléans wrote in 1718, and I said, "My son gave his sister an elegant present, a nécessaire, that is a rectangular box containing porcelain cups and everything that is needing for taking coffee, tea, or chocolate. And then underneath there were gold objects, a needle case, thimble, corkscrew case, two golden boxes, and some more things, all made of pure gold and finely worked." And the fact that she felt the need to explain what a necessaire was explains that this was a newly introduced object. Now, she describes a regular necessaire and not a necessaire de poche, or a pocket one with these miniature implements. And here we see another one. They were made in various countries. Here's a lovely one made by the entrepreneur, or organized by the entrepreneur, James Cox, of very lush materials like the moss agate, and then set with stones and rubies and diamonds, perhaps for the export to overseas, we don't quite know. And here then the myriad of little implements inside. Or another German one, this lovely mother of pearl one, beautifully decorated with rococo decoration in gold. Again, this lovely chinoiserie taste. And I hope you have all recognized the poster. And of course, we hope that this draws the visitor into see the exhibition. All these beautiful necessaires and all these other lovely boxes, they seem to have been the foremost luxury trinkets of the 18th century. and they continue to fascinate us today. And I do hope that if you haven't had a chance to visit the exhibition, that you will go up either later today or come back another time to look at these various objects that we have for you on display all throughout the summer. And I do invite you, unlike this cat, to think outside the box and be open-minded about it. Thank you very much. Now, I have the distinct pleasure to introduce our next speaker to you, Charles or Charlie Truman, who comes from us from London, and it is a great treat to have him here to talk to us about the 18th century gold box, the ultimate fashion accessory, and microcosm of all the arts. Mr. Truman started his career at the V&A and in the various departments, ranging from the woodwork, and then, as he said in his own words, until he saw the light, and moved on to the metalwork department and the porcelain department. After the V&A, he's also worked at Christie's and lately at Osprey, and has been the author of many books on gold boxes, including the James Rothschild collection at Waddesdon Manor, the Gilbert collection of gold boxes, and most recently his book on gold boxes at the Wallace collection. He has also written extensively on Renaissance jewelry, and we are all waiting for his catalogue of the Renaissance jewelry of the Lehman collection here in this building to come out. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Truman.
I don't know how to follow that, but after Daniëlle's wonderful exposition, gold seems rather boring, but gold, it's such a wonderful, soft metal. It's the most marvelous thing. We all today have gold rings, gold bracelets, gold cufflinks, but not many of us have gold boxes. And that's my subject today. And gold box is a wonderfully useful catch-all expression which describes things that are not just of gold, but of whom gold forms at least the most important part. And I'm sorry to say that I'm going to have to copy some of Daniela's images, because we're going to start right here. And you've already seen him before. But this is, as it says, we don't need a lecturer these days, do we? It's always up on the screen. Duval de Lepinois, who was one of the grand men of the 18th century, sitting at his desk with his gold snuff box. Now, the fact that this picture was painted at all shows that he was confident in this style of being. This was his way of life. His snuff box was part of his existence. In order to understand this whole idea of snuff, I'm afraid I'm going to digress a little bit in order to tell you what it is. There's some down here. If anybody wants to try it, there's also a box of tissues. But I brought some along just for fun. But snuff essentially is tobacco ground up and scented with aromatic oils and herbs. You normally take it through the nose. But the idea of snuff was originally, it became from the Americas terribly early. I'm sorry, I hope that's not an offensive term to say the Americas, is it? Is that all right? And Roman Payne, who went with Christopher Columbus on his second trip to the New World, recorded in 1497 the sniffing up of snuff through tubes. In about 1550, Richard Eden recorded that the tribes of Haiti, when they had a difficult problem to resolve, went into their houses, which he said that they entered into their houses, where snuffing up into their nostrils is the very powdered herb they call cohoba, which is what I assume we mean now by cohiba cigars. that by called Cahoba, and they say immediately that they see their houses turn topsy-turvy. The men walk with their heels upwards. Of such force is this powder, utterly to take away all senses. And throughout the early 16th century, and this is really at the beginning of the New World, I mean, it seems to me that something that spreads incredibly early. Tobacco is recorded as far afield as in Brazil, Mexico, Texas, Canada, and Florida. And by 1548, it was being grown in Europe. In fact, it was being grown in Portugal, where a man called Dominao de Goes showed the French ambassador, Jean-Nico de Nîmes, this tobacco plant, and it was Nîmes, Jean-Nico, who gave his name to Tobacco Canum Nicotana, the tobacco plant as we know it today, and also to the narcotic we all know called nicotine. From Brazil, tobacco moved to Spain, where it went all over Europe, until in the 16th century, it was considered particularly useful, not for smoking or taking in your nose, but as a medicine. And in 1599, Henry Butts wrote that tobacco cureth all the griefs, dolours, opilation, epostume, and obstruction proceeding from cold or wind, especially in the head or the breast. The leaves are good for the migraine, cold stomachs, sick kidneys, toothache, fits of the mother, naughty breath, scalding, and other burnings. So it was a real wonderful solution to all your ills. And by 1624, the Pope, Urban VIII, had banned the use of tobacco in the mass, which maybe seemed unreasonable to you and me. And in 1635, the sale of tobacco was prohibited in France to apothecaries' shops. By the mid-17th century, the use of tobacco had taken off as being the most wonderful cure-all. Molière, who I'm sure you're all familiar with, opened Don Juan with a panegyric on snuff. And from France, the habit spread to Holland, and then to England, where Charles II and his mistress, Nell Gwyn, both took snuff. And by 1702, no less than 7,000 shops were selling snuff in London. And by the middle of the 18th century, Dean Swift, Jonathan Swift, wrote that the makers of snuff employ by far the greatest number of hands of all manufacturers in the kingdom. So the use of tobacco and the snuff was a huge industry. As I said, much of the snuff used to come from Spain, but by the middle of the 18th century, Virginia was supplying almost all the tobacco to Europe. And indeed, it was supplied not only to Europe, but we exported it back through Glasgow to the Americas. And £35 million of that's weight, not value, of tobacco was being exported through Glasgow. Now, this newfound fashion obviously not only inspired newfound containers, but also a newfound habit of taking snuff. And in 1711, The Spectator, which is a mag that's still going on today, but The Spectator said, the exercise of the snuff box, according to the most fashionable airs and notions in the opposition to the exercise of the fan, will be taught in the best possible manner by perfumed or plain snuff at Charles Lillis's. And Mr. Lillis's ritual was recorded by someone who actually should be here today, and sadly is not, but Claire Le Corbeil, who worked at this museum, who was a wonderful, wonderful scholar on the snuff box and a hugely generous person, should be where I am standing. But she quoted this wonderful ritual, which I'm translating for the French, and my translation may not be quite as good as hers. But you take the snuff box in the right hand, you pass it to the left hand, you tap the snuff box, you open the snuff box, you offer it to the company, you bring it back to yourself. Holding the snuff box open, you take some snuff in your fingers. It says, sniff avec justesse. So you had to get a good go. Then return the snuff box, close the snuff box. Rather unfortunately, it says, then sneeze, cough, or spit, and finish. It's, for all this elegance, it seems odd to end that way. Never mind. But boxes of snuff, like you see here with the Vin de Lepanois, were worn the Duchess of Portland made Dean Swift some pockets that hung on his belt for his boxes. So you can imagine these were carried. They were, as I said in my opening slide, they are the ultimate fashion accessory. These were what she showed around. Richard Steele, against writing in The Spectator, disapproved of, and I quote, "The impertinent customer of women, fine women, have lately taken into of taking snuff, especially at dinner, when an upper lip mixed with snuff and the sauce is all that is presented to the observation of all. Indeed, ladies of the court, including Queen Charlotte, who I have to say was your last queen, was one of the great snuff takers of all time." Rather curiously, and we have to talk about France here, because France, as you all know this, but France was the center of fashion in Europe, and everywhere else followed on. The Prussians might not agree, but I didn't, Wilfram. But France was the center of Europe, and so we looked to France. And the earliest mention of a boîte is not a box at all. It is, in fact, a jeweled miniature, which was called a boîte à portrait, a portrait book. The auction houses still talk about boîte à portrait, but forget it, it's nonsense. This is what a boîte à portrait is. And there is a wonderful document in France called the Register of the King's Gifts, which records the successive monarchs' gifts to ambassadors, to dignitaries, to artists even. And the boîte à portrait, this jeweled box, which in fact in England was called a picture box, is the ultimate gift. Now the great thing about them is that they were immediately split up for the jewels, which were recycled into more fashionable works of art, but the portraits survive. And Louis XIV gave over 410 of these during his relatively long reign. The earliest record of these is in 1667, when Louis XIV gave two boîte à portrait, which cost 15,000 livres, to the médiateurs de Suède. These were the negotiators during the wars in the north. Now, it's incredibly difficult to work out prices for you, but there were 24 livres, approximately, to the British pound, and by the time you'd worked out getting a dollar in 1794, I think it was, there were $4 to the pound. The dollar is about the same as the Prussian thaler, so you divide by four to get the right number. The use of a tabatière, or snuff box, comes around about 1660, when Berthaud's Paris Burlesque refers to a tabatière à bois. But the earliest reference in the Register of the King's Gifts, which is this wonderful document of the King's presence, is in 1714, when Louis XIV gave to the Cardinal del Giudice, the Grand Inquisitor of Spain, three étuis of gold with scissors, three boîte à mouches, which is what Daniëlle showed you recently with the little patch boxes, and eight snuff boxes in gold and shell, which is probably looks something like this. This is a box that was in, I'm sorry, by the way, you probably have huge problems with calling it snuff box, all one word. I've tried to get it right. A hyphenated snuff box was suggested to me that looked like a New York gangster's funeral coffin. So we've kept it to the OED, one word, snuff box. So just, I'm sorry if that's all right. Every other book I've ever done, I've had it hyphenated, but this seems to be the right way of doing it. But this is probably the earliest sort of snuff box that was introduced around about, this one dates from 1770 to 22, but around about that sort of date. The earliest box that we could actually talk about today, which is what we're talking about, is this piece, which is a box in the Gilbert Collection in London. It used to be in LA, which has the monogram of Felipe V of Spain and his wife, is Isabella of Parma. And this must date, well, the hallmarks date between 1770 and 1722, but there was an arrêt de conseil, a law, in Paris passed on the 23rd of November 1721, which allowed one to use more than 1 ounce of gold in a box. Before that, 1 ounce of gold was the maximum allowance, and they said you could use up to 7 ounces after 1721. Now, this doesn't use 7 ounces, but it certainly used a lot more than 1 ounce. And so this must have been made between that date, which is 23rd of November, and 15th of February 1722, when the hallmark changed. So here we have a wonderful thing. The fact that the box was made for a Spanish king is not surprising, since this is where snuff was coming into Europe. So there was Felipe V. You probably all know this. I don't know why I even bother. Felipe V was the grandson of Louis XIV, who was bunged onto the throne of Spain. It was just one of those things that happened in those days. But there we go. The earliest box that we can identify in the Register of the King's Gifts is this wonderful piece by Daniëlle, who actually was a Fleming who worked in Paris. And it is in the Louvre, which is the right place for that box to be. It was given to Monsieur Opp, who was the ambassador from the Netherlands, in 1725. And it has portraits by Massé of Louis XIV and Louis XV and his wife on the inside. The enamel, for those of you who are sort of anoraks in enamel, is probably by a man called Yuage, who we don't know who he was, but this style of enameling is very much his style, particularly the translucent leaves is always referred to in 18th century documents. But there's no signed piece by Yuage, but this is, I think, Yuage. Now, both these boxes are here in the Met, which is why I've illustrated them. They're both by Daniëlle Goers, and they date from the 1720s and 30s. Now, the one thing about Goers is that we know that a man called Gérard de Bêche was his chaser. Chasing, you again probably know, is moving metal around without actually taking it off. Unlike engraving, where you scrape metal off, chasing is pushing it around. And these are presumably chased by Gérard de Bêche, who charged Guers 120 livres, 10 shillings, $2, to do the business. And de Bêche was a nightmare. I mean, he wasn't all bad. He was a womanizer and a drunk. So he had some good sides. But he used to go around Paris saying, there is just one God and one de Bêche, which actually was a lie, because there were two de Bêches, his father and son. And the de Bêche who chased this box, or these boxes, is de Bêche Père, who also chased a wonderful box in Mrs. Reitzman's collection, which is signed de Bêche, and another in the Givaudan collection in Geneva. But his son, I think, was this de Bêche. Well, this box is signed de Bêche, but doesn't say père or fils. But this is in the Gilbert collection, and this is a much sort of softer, I was going to say sexier, is that a rude word to say here? It's a much nicer way of chasing it. This is really subtle stuff. The dad was a bit heavy-handed, but the son was brilliant. There was another way of decorating boxes, if you needed to, which is a way that we don't often think of these days, which is using a machine, engine turning. And this box, which is in the Wallace collection in London, it was always thought to have been hand-chased, but I'm reliably instructed that it's turned on a wheel using, and again, if you're any anoraks around, an elliptical chuck and an 8-wave rosette, with every other wave subdivided into 8 further divisions, which gives you this wonderful decoration. It's very, very clever way of decorating a box. And bear this in mind, because we'll come back to it later in this talk, but this is a mechanical way of decorating boxes, which wasn't necessarily very cheap, and it had been used in ivory since the 15th century, but not until gold, until the early part of the 18th century. Originally, everybody thought that engine turning on gold started in the 1750s. This box actually dates from 1740 to 41, and there is a box that I know which dates from 1738 to 9, which is in a collection not a million miles away from here. But where the French goldsmiths really excelled was in the use of coloured golds. Now, this is a wonderful, the wonderful technique, bringing out the relief of gold decoration in different colours. You can colour gold in lots of different ways. White gold, which you can see very much in the here and here, was used adding charcoal iron. Red gold was used, you used a lot of copper. And there are various different compositions of alloy, which still kept the gold up to its standard, which is, in France, 20.25 carat. That's quite gutsy. And most of your jewellery will be 18 if you're lucky. This is 20.25. It's very heavy stuff. Now, I included this one. Oops, I beg your pardon. Let's go back. This box, because the same scene, this box is by Jean Georges, and the same scene was used on a box in Mrs. Reitzman's collection here. It's actually got rather a prettier enamel border. But it is quite remarkable, this scene. On here you have hunting dogs, which are probably Louis XIV's hunting dogs. I think the one on top is a dog called Ten. Although I have to say, in the illustration that I found of him, he looks a rather better fed. But on this side, you've got these curious little boys dressed as soldiers, particularly down here. You may find that rather questionable taste, but it's certainly was popular in the 18th century. But the colour gold, each separate piece had to be applied, and when you applied it, you had to heat it. Now, the heat changed the colour, so the gold had to then be pickled or dipped in acid and then repolished. So it's an immensely complicated process. We look at this thing and we think, gosh, that's jolly clever. Well, it was jolly clever. But enamel was where the French goldsmiths really excelled. And this box is by Jean de Crolet, who is arguably the most famous gold box maker ever. And this is probably the most famous box in the world. It's one of the few boxes you can trace back to an 18th century collection. And it was in a collection, as you can see, from the Delon. And in his sale, it was valued, well, before he died, actually, it was valued as un boîte en or, en coquille, émaillé en plume de paillon, in peacock's feathers. And it was valued at 360 livres, which is a relatively small amount. At his sale in 1782, it made 856 livres, which is still quite a small amount, but it was the only box in his sale that must have dated before about 1770. So this was a box, and I'm sorry it's such a dreadful slide. It really is awful, isn't it? It's all out of focus. But this was a box that was really appreciated and loved in the 1780s as being one of the great works of Goldsmith's work. And I hope you'll agree with me that it is. This is one of my favourite boxes of all time. It's, as you see, by Hubert Chaval, and probably decorated by his son, who had this rather pompous name of Hubert Chaval, Hubert Louis Chaval de Saint-Louis. Saint-Hubert, sorry. It's in the Wallace collection, and it's after engravings by Boucher. And it is so close. It's one begs the question of actually how close the relationship is. But what one wants to know is, although the son, Hubert Louis, may have done the enamelling, who actually engraved the ground? Because that's the real million-dollar question. It's so beautifully detailed. And this is Fishing by Cormorants from Scenes of Chinese Life by Boucher. And this is at the bottom of the box, which is, as you can see, the flutist. The enfant tabalier down here seems to have been missed out, but there we go. These things happen. But the quality of this box is so ravishing, so wonderful. The size is quite small, so I think it must have been a box that would be described as pour femme, a lady's box in the 18th century. But it's really the most wonderful thing. Now, when people had gold boxes, they quite often had scenes on them that were immediately recognizable to their fellows. This one shows on the cover a version of Echo Domestique. Echo Domestique by Boucher. But those of you interested in room interiors will notice that the two little upturned, presumably Blanchine cups and saucers on the mantelpiece. So you all go back and do your Blanchine cups and saucers on the mantelpiece, please. And also, in this instance, the artist, who I think is a man called a woman called Le Sœur, has placed a spaniel on the lap of the mother who's teaching her children. Also by Le Sœur is this box, which is actually by a man called Nolan Ladivier, which I would love to be able to prove was made for Madame de Pompadour. I can't, because the box which seemed closest to this in the Marquis de Marigny, who is Madame de Pompadour's brother, in his sale, refers to 8 scenes, and this obviously only has 6. So I'm not quite sure how this happened. But the subjects are taken up here from the overdoors of the chateau of Bellevue, Madame de Pompadour's chateau, which is shown down here. I mean, it's so obvious that it must be for her. It's very frustrating that one can't actually pin it down. But it's interesting to see how Le Sœur has expanded the overdoors to fit the rectangular shape of the box. And here you've got this little girl here, who is thought to be Alexandrine, who is Madame de Pompadour's daughter. And you've got her here. But obviously, there's a lot going on down here. So he's put another little Alexandrine down here. And similarly, with music, there's a lot going on here, which is missing on this side. So he's had to put in a screen and other bits and pieces to fill out what was essentially a Boucher, a Van Loo engraving of an overdoor from Madame de Pompadour's house. So these guys could paint. I mean, this is what's important. We always think that enamels were just copyists, but they could actually do a bit more original work. And I include this one because it's in your show, in Daniëlle's show downstairs, of a really beautiful box, which has the Boucher engraving of Le Crepe. The girls are cooking pancakes here. It's in reverse, but that's the way of the world. But just wonderful to show that this is the way people were thinking of. When you presented a box, were you presenting a snuff box or were you presenting a Boucher illustration? This is the million-dollar question. But this wonderful decoration right here is absolutely brilliant. So I hadn't realized how good it was until I came to see the show. It's a really good box. Now, this painting is here, so you all know it. But it comes from Madame de Pompadour's bathroom at Bellevue. You've probably all been there. But here we have it on a box here. It wasn't engraved until much, much later. The box dates from 1764-5, which is the year that Madame de Pompadour died. So I don't think it possibly belonged to her. But the painting belonged to her brother, the Marquis de Marigny. And I think that this enamel may also belong to him, because it's clear that the box has been re-enameled to take that particular illustration. So I think Marigny may have owned both the painting and the enamel as a sort of aide-mémoire to his sister's work of art. Now, lacquer. You all, I'm sure, all know about lacquer because it was an incredibly rare and sought-after subject in the 18th century. And on the box on the left is a box in Heine Thyssen's collection, or Jorn Thyssen's collection, as you know, which is probably from a lacquer panel that was cut up by Jean de Crolle, because we know that he bought panels of lacquer from the Marchand Messier, the dealer, Lazare Duveau, in 1751, which cost, is described as being in black on, with gold leaves, and that seems to figure quite well on that, and it cost 96 livres. And the box on the right, which is a lovely box, and in 18th and early 19th century sale catalogues, boxes are only attributed to any maker if their name is written on it. Now, Louis de Roussel was one of the makers who wrote his name on the front here, and this box, I think, is the one that occurred in Queen Charlotte's collection. She was, after all, your last queen, which was described as a small gold box by Roussel of Paris, the panels filled with specimens of gold Japanese lacquer, and it cost £15, which was in 1819. Very obscure. Queen Charlotte's sale was an anonymous sale at Christie's in 1819. None of the sort of flurry of a great queen's sale. Now, the other way of decorating a box was with miniatures, and miniatures could show a scene of great history, your house, all sorts of occasions. On the left, these are both boxes by a man called Pierre-François Drey, who was Jean de Crolle's pupil. And on the left is a box showing a curious event at Compiègne, where you can see a stag was chased to the top of a cottage. And the master of the hunt, I have to say with less respect for the householders he might have had, cut the beams of the cottage so that the stag fell through and could be killed. Why are you laughing? these things happen. and anyway, but it's a wonderful box. On this side, we have an even more extraordinary scene, which is the chateau of Romanville, which had a wonderful garden. You can see a jardin chinois anglois around the bottom. But here, we have the Marquis de Segur, the owner of Romanville, slightly turned to one side because he'd lost his arm in the war, with his wife. They're both wearing the Order of the Saint-Esprit, and with a young girl here with a headdress on, a priest. And this celebrates a strange ceremony called the Ceremony of the Rosaire, whereby the local seigneur, in this case the Marquis de Segur, and the local priest identified a virgin who was given her dowry by the Marquis. Quite how they verified her virginity, I'll leave to our imagination. But quite interesting, when Madame Vigier Lebrun, the painter, visited Romanville in 1788, just shortly after this box was painted, she said that the peasants no longer took off their hats. On the contrary, they looked very sullenly at us, and some of them even menaced us with their sticks. One might have felt a revolution coming on if you were sort of thinking along that line. And I moved to England, and this is, to my mind, the greatest English snuff box in existence, and it's here. You're jolly lucky to have it. It belongs to Mrs. Reitzman, and it's in the gallery just up the road. But it's chased by a man called George Michael Moser, who was a Swiss who came from Schaffhausen and developed the art of chasing in England to a high degree. English chasing, gold chasing, again, I said moving around metal, it was at its high point in the mid-18th century. And this is a wonderful subject. It shows a guy called Moses Skyvola putting his hand in the fire because he thought he had killed Lars Porsner, who's sitting here. But in fact, he just killed his secretary. It was a mistake. It just happens, these things. And this, I think, was given by the City of London to Admiral Vernon, who had just conquered the port of Portobello in Panama. in 1741. It's the most wonderful box. You really must just go and stand outside and pray. Moser was obviously also very interested in classical subjects, and here we have a gem. That's the actual size. A gem from Baron Stosch's book called Gemmae Antiqua Caelatae. And here we have it here, of love overcoming strength. And you can see here this coloured golds. I mean, this is really very, very Frenchified English goldsmithing. But sticking to the classical subject. And then Moser in enamel. Now, I only included this box because you've got the tapestries here. These are tapestries, these are engravings, rather, here from Charles Coppel's History of Don Quixote. And here we have them in enamel. You've got them in tapestry in the Met, and they are most wonderful. The instant is a double box, so you could have two lots of snuff. It's quite a sort of clever little thing. There's also a watch in the box, they knew what time it was. And then English enamel really took off at the time when we were doing what we were best at, which was beating the French. This is a box by James Morrissey, which shows rather grand view of the Battle of the Nile after a man called Robert Cheveley. But it is a wonderful piece of enamelling, also a rather grand piece of goldsmith work. That's in the National Maritime Museum. But to move further east to Vienna. So many enamelers worked both on porcelain and on gold. And this is a guy called Philipp Ernst Schindler, who was sacked from the Meissen factory for working on his own account. And he was enameling copper and base metals, as well as porcelain. But here we have a scene on the cover, which is very much a normal David Tennis scene. It's called, actually, Déjeuner Flamand. But you couldn't quite call it much else. But to show how difficult it is to track these things down, here you have Schindler's, the bottom of the box, and you've got this hideous old hag looking out of the window here. The jealous wife to this old boy. But the girl has been substituted here, not for this girl, but for a Boucher girl, and the two children are clearly from Boucher. So you've got both David Teniers and François Boucher in the same box. And this is one of the problems. You think you've nailed it with one illustration, and suddenly you find that there are a whole bunch of others coming in there. But even this is reproduced here, whereas this old dear is looking in the window here. But so that's Schindler using both Teniers and Boucher to come up with the same composition. In Dresden, again, moving a bit further up the Rhine, maybe, there was a wonderful store of hard stones, and the goldsmiths of Dresden used hard stones to decorate their boxes in an almost better way than anybody else. They're both the boxes are by this man called Johann Christian Neuber, who was the stone cutter to the court and indeed director of the Green Vaults in Dresden. This one has a portrait or a depiction of Leder and the Swan. You couldn't just see it, I'm afraid. I'm sorry, but in the base there's a little secret compartment, which now reveals portraits of Voltaire and Madame du Châtelet, his mistress, both of which must be later than the box, actually. But the fact that they're there is extraordinary that in the 1860s, when the box was sold, the miniatures were noted, but they weren't discovered again until 1976, when somebody happened to push the right little button and the miniatures popped out. And on the left-hand screen, there's quite a pretty Hull miniature. It was probably a later replacement. Almost all the miniatures on Dresden boxes are later. And this is it's a very sad thing, but most of the ladies of the court in Dresden were hideously ugly. This is despite the fact that, Augustus the Strong, that ever cheerful man of sin, seems to have seduced most of them, but that's the way of the world. And Hanau is the new kid on the block. A very clever chap from the Bayerisches Nationalmuseum called Lawrence Sailing has identified Hanau as being the great producer of gold boxes, where these were almost always called Swiss. This one is signed down here by a man called Kraft, who we know was in Hanau in between 1782 and 1789. And this box here, which has a rather dull scene of it's after Groers, it's the village agreement, which would be very good for Hanau. Hanau was a great Protestant town, and this shows a wedding delivered before a notary rather than before a priest, and so it would have gone down very well in a Protestant Hanau. Now, the great feature of this, which I noted earlier, was engine turning, I think about my third slide. In 1784, an engine turner called Flemont agreed to engine turn a minimum of 400 boxes per year for four other goldsmiths. That's a huge output. It's this is one of them, but it's absolutely vast output. And I said in my introduction that this was going to be a survey of all the arts. We've done paintings. This is opera. I mean, you can see from this slide that you're meant to be looking into a theatre. And this is a box that came from the Empress of France, Empress Eugenie, who seems to have brought these things with her just to sort of keep her going. And it's painted with the subject of Armida, from that wonderful poem, which you all read, I know, called Gerusalemme Liberata by Torquato Tasso. And this, you have Armida, which was taken from an opera performed in Berlin in 1751. And this seems to me to be the ultimate celebration of a great opera. It's the top and bottom, but it's absolutely a wonderful thing. And it's probably painted by a man called Isaac Jakob Klauser, who again was another porcelain painter who worked on gold boxes. He worked for the Vegli factory, for Gottskowski, and also for the Königliche Porzellan Manufacture in Berlin. So you've got here, you've got a porcelain painter again, like Schindler, working on gold. Now, I put this in, I'm sorry, because Daniëlle asked me about this, and it has this maker's mark DB, but it's Berlin, so pass on out. Go. Right. I don't know who DB is. He may be Baudisson, he may be a retailer. But the whole Berlin thing comes with this box in the Louvre on the left and this box in the Torn and Taxis collection on the right. I don't know if you saw the Torn and Taxis collection when it was shown in Munich. All the boxes in Torn and Taxis, they're very Germanic, they're bigger. They're larger than life size. This one here is almost twice the size of that. It's very strange, but they have this very distinctive coloured gold figures, which we now think are probably Berlin. And this is really the holy grail of Berlin. This is the most wonderful box. It's a lousy slide, I know, but it's signed here by Kruger. Or Cruget, but for John Guillaume Georges Cruget, who moved to Berlin in 1753. He was invited to move. Frederick the Great of Prussia was trying to create Paris in the middle of Germany, and he wanted the best goldsmiths, the best painters, the best philosophes as well to go. Cruget was one of the people who went. The interesting thing about this box is every single print that it's taken from, and they're all taken from Boothier engravings, were all published before 1753. So Cruget took them with him from Paris to Berlin. Now, Frederick, as I said, was trying to create Paris in Germany, But he had a different idea of boxes. These boxes weren't for carrying on your person, although he did carry them. And in fact, one of them stopped a bullet for him. But these were table boxes, big lumps. You sat around your house to show how grand you were. And this one is Lion Gilbert, was in Torn and Taxes. But you have to, it's a slight stretch of the imagination, but this is a Crugier design for this box. And there were originally 40 designs by Crugier for Gold boxes. Unfortunately, our combined lads did quite a good job on Berlin in 1944, and there are now only 18. But there were 40, but there we go. And you could have it any colour you liked. It's a bit like going into mallets, really. On the left-hand screen is a box that's here that nobody seems to know about. This is a box that's in Lehman. And it's a wonderful box. It's been mucked about with, but it's a wonderful box. And it's in blue glass. And the Jordan brothers, who are one of the two major suppliers of boxes to Frederick the Great, frequently talk about something called pierre d'émail, which to me seems to be stone in enamel. And since enamel was coloured glass, this is, I think, what we're talking about. And so on the left-hand screen, I think, is a box by pierre d'émail, in pierre d'émail, supplied by the Jordans. On the right is a box in chrysoprase, which has nothing whatsoever to do with Crugier, but I think it's probably designed by Cuvillier. But it's in chrysoprase, this funny green stone, it looks like a lump of soap. But chrysoprase was very good at getting rid of gout, and that was one of the problems that Frederick the Great had. So he loved boxes in chrysoprase. You can't actually tie up any of the boxes with his orders, but there are several that do apply. I think this is the most wonderful box. I suspect that the diamonds on this box should be foiled pink, like on this, but they're not now. This box should be here. It belonged to Robert Lehman. I don't know when it left the collection, but Arthur Gilbert bought it from Harry Winston, together with a lot of yellow diamonds, but that's another story. And it has this wonderful depiction here of the Udri Signe Barbe, but the scene has been sort of disappeared to become a duck. But the dog is quite good. But all in hard sense, it's amazing that this should be on the bottom of the box. And to pick that up, I mean, it's unbelievable to turn it over and see that. It's the ultimate thing to find. A wonderful depiction. And I had to ask earlier if you had the expression in this country, bling. Because this is bling. You don't get more bling than this. I think it's the most vulgar box I've ever seen in my life. This, again, came from Frederick the Great, belonged to the Duke of Mecklenburg-Schwerin, subsequently to the Duke of Anhalt-Dassau, who we all think in England that Queen Victoria's progeny went all over Europe, but Anhalt-Dassau's progeny went even further. But this, again, has the strange... These coloured stones aren't stones at all, they're glass, and it is this pierre d'émail. But this seems to me to be the ultimate statement of Frederick the Great's self-confidence. I mean, you know, you can read what you like in it. He lived a celibate life, but there we are. It's impossible for us to know how people viewed these boxes in the 18th century. We simply have no idea. We can't think. I mean, if you were offered a box by after Boucher, did it mean something different to a box after a box by Teniers? Did a box like this mean something to you? Was this what... obviously, it showed huge wealth. I mean, it's covered in diamonds. One doesn't know. What one can say is that all the boxes that I've shown today were made for probably the most discerning clientele that the world has ever seen. These guys knew exactly what they wanted, and their scope of discernment was unbelievable. So what you have here, to my mind, are not only the greatest fashion accessories, but also some of the greatest works of art you will ever see from the 18th century. Thank you.
for already welcoming our performers. We're very excited to have Artek here with Gwendolyn Toth. And just in case you had missed the connection with the boxes, just to briefly point out to you that we have a real treat here, that several instruments on which the performers are going to be playing are from our own collection, including the harpsichord from Rome from the 17th century, which is actually nothing more than a box in the sense that it has an outer case and an inner case. The outer case is the decorated box in which the instrument is stored. And then later on this afternoon, there's also going to be a box organ, and I guess that is self-explanatory. So thank you very much, and please help us to welcome Artek.
As it says in the program, we did call our music today jukeboxes from the past. And so most of this first set of five pieces that we're going to play for you are essentially popular music from 400 and 500 years ago. Dance tunes. The first piece is a dance tune. The piece that Motomi will play on the gamba is a dance piece. The second piece I'm playing is what we call an intabulation of a madrigal, which is sort of a way to ornament a piece that was originally designed for many singers to be played on the keyboard, very possibly within the, you know, for your own private pleasure in your court. Because, of course, we know probably members of the lower classes in 1600 did not have access to the beautiful Zente harpsichord or the beautiful gammas that we have today. So we're going to go ahead and play a bit for you.
Thank you.
course, this is an extremely beautiful gamba, and the thing that, about the decoration that's particularly unusual is that right here in the front is a carnation, which is probably some connection with the flower that signifies a particular family that owned it, perhaps something like that. And it has beautiful decoration on the back as well. And I think Susanna, our conservator here at the museum, following the concert, might allow us to pull the inner harpsichord. You see, it's an inner harpsichord in a box. She might allow us to pull it out partway and show you. We don't really want to do it when I'm about to play it because we have to take the lid down and everything. But that's a very typical feature for an Italian 17th century harpsichord. And this is a Roman harpsichord. And the pieces we just played are from Spain, Naples. Well, England is not so connected, but they are music that one would have played on this harpsichord at that time. And now we're going to bring in our voice box. He's a very elegantly decorated voice box, wouldn't you say? This is Philip Anderson.
Thank you. Just a few quick words about this song. You probably can't see your program. This song is over a ground bass, which you'll hear. And the singer's lover, Lila, has left him for another man. He's very upset about this, and he's trying to justify his feelings. First he's angry, then he's trying to say, well, I can accept this, and then he's angry again. But in the end, he is very angry, but he says, I will always love you, Lila.
Thank you.
I'm going to leave this beautiful Italian harpsichord behind, which makes me a bit sad. It's a great pleasure to be able to play an antique that you know that 400 years of people have played it before you. So, this is the first thing that came to my mind when they asked me to design some music to go with an exhibition of boxes. We call this a box organ because it is a box of pipes. So, there they are. It is not an electronic organ, of course, by any means. It's just a very small pipe organ. There were many found in Italy, a little larger than this, which were, in a residence, and had 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 stops at the most. This is a 4-stop organ, and I'm going to play. Oops. One more Italian dance piece for you. Thank you. It's just a clip. This organ was made. This one is actually 2003. The one listed in your program was my own, but it had a little problem last week, and so we switched it for this one, which is exactly the same, but a few years newer. So this is another ground bass piece, similar to the piece that Philip sang. That was based on a 4-note descending note theme in the bass. And this one is more of a dance with a lively C major happy theme. It does have an electric motor, which my son is very happy about, because in the old days he would have been required to pump. Okay. So, for the rest of our program, we're moving into the 18th century. I'm going to just say a little bit about the harpsichord, and I'd like to begin by saying I'm greatly indebted to Mr. Nicholas Bunning, who owns this harpsichord and who makes it very available for myself and a number of other harpsichordists to borrow when we want something that is simply spectacular, because as you see, the decoration, the beautiful painting, there's a soundboard painting of flowers, and of course this very Italianate outer case, and then the completely, I could say gilded, but gild usually implies gold. This is actual silver on the stand. It was made in Mexico, and it's quite, I think, the most fabulous harpsichord that is a modern harpsichord here in New York City. And this is a copy of an original harpsichord by a maker named Rooker's, which was a Flemish harpsichord, built in the early 17th century, that then, in the 18th century, French builders took it and did what they called a ravalement, which means that they increased the size of it. So what we have here is a copy of a Flemish harpsichord enlarged in the 18th century. This incorporates all those two centuries of changes in this copy. So it is perfect for the music of French composers, and of course very nice for the music of Bach, which we're going to play. And Emmanuel Davis, our flutist, is going to say a word about his flute.
Sure. This flute fits loosely into the program because it's boxwood. The question I'm most frequently asked about this flute is, why is it stained this color? Why is it black and brown? And the answer to that is this. In the 18th century, well-to-do people had flutes that were hard woods, like grenadilla and ebony, and those were black woods. And not so well-to-do people, wanting to look well-to-do, would take boxwood flutes and stain them black. And so the original of this flute is boxwood that had been stained black, but this is how the stain had worn away after being played. So the maker who made this for me, a man named Toots, oddly enough, he stained it that way so it would look like the original. So.
Thank you.
our next piece by Bach is a gamba solo. And now this is not a part of the museum's collection, although I got a little hint backstage that perhaps they wish it was. So this is also an antique gamba by Barak Norman, and beautifully decorated, very similar to the other one. It's also six strings, yes. So is there any difference between this and the other one?
Age wise, this is 1714, yes. And then the other one is sometime in the 17th century, so maybe earlier, 100 years earlier.
Thank you.
French pieces, the left. The first one is a very short piece for harpsichord. I wanted to play you something very typical for this instrument. This is an unmeasured prelude by Jean-Philippe Rameau, who, of course, is one of the most famous French Baroque composers. And unmeasured means that it is written without exact time values. So it's basically a written-out improvisation. Now we're actually going to do one last piece for all of us, and Philip's going to just give you a little bit about it.
This song is from a cantata called Arion, or we say Arion in English. Arion is a character from Greek mythology. He was a beautiful young man, the favorite of the king of Crete. He was a singer and a poet. He sails to Sicily to compete in a singing competition, which he wins. And he comes back with a lot of gold and a lot of lauds and honors. The sailors on the ship are so jealous of him that they tell him they're going to throw him overboard and steal his gold. So he says, "May I please sing one last song before you kill me?" And he sings a song. Now, the aria that we're going to do describes that the song is so beautiful that the waves stop crashing, the winds stop blowing, the sea nymphs warm their cold hearts, and even Neptune himself stops. And that's what we're doing. I'll tell you what happens at the end of the story, though. A dolphin saves him. A dolphin gives him a ride back to Crete on his back, and Arion tells the king what happened. And Arion hides behind a curtain, and the sailors come in. They say, "Oh, we lost poor Arion. He fell overboard and drowned." And Arion steps out from behind the curtain. So it ends happily for Arion, but very unhappily for the sailors.